kick off the Miller Center's 2023 Democracy and Capitalism Scholars Conference, and the opening plenary entitled, Can Democracy and Capitalism Coexist? America's Founding Question. This conference is organized by the Miller Center's New Democracy and Capitalism Project, led by our faculty, who are also faculty of the University of Virginia, Sid Milkis, Mimi Riley, Scott Miller, and Bob Bruner, and supported by Chrissy Linsenberger, who serves exquisitely as our project facilitator. The conference is also generously supported by the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, to whom we're very grateful, and some other supporters of the project who I'll turn to in a bit. I want to start by giving big thanks to Bob Bruner, who is not on the dais with us, but whose idea this undertaking was. Bob was the dean at our Darden Business School for a decade. He taught at the Miller Center a course on presidential leadership, which we were thrilled to host. And then he started teaching a course on financial crises, building off interviews that he helped conduct for the Miller Center, oral history interviews of the 2008-2009 crisis, which were part of both our George W. Bush oral history project and our Barack Obama oral history project. That became a course on democracy and capitalism. And at some level, this conference is a culmination of those efforts and of Bob's entire intellectual career as a student of financial crises and how political systems respond to those crises. But the project goes beyond this intellectual dimension. As a matter of institution building and culture building, this project is a paradigm, and Bob is a paragon. He is great at enlisting colleagues in these efforts from diverse fields and backgrounds. Sid Milkis is a political scientist. Scott Miller is a political and economic historian. Bob himself is a professor of finance. And as I was accounting before, and I'll account soon, Mimi Riley teaches in 5 schools at the university, including the Public Policy School, the Law School, the School of Medicine. She's really an extraordinary resource for all of us, and Bob pulls all of that together. Through a workshop series, this project has built a network of scholars across UVA who care deeply about this issue, both in the sense of how market democracies and capitalist systems work together and how they are often at crisis with one another. The entire team comes at this with a shared feeling that our country requires broader understanding of what democracy and capitalism are and how they work together or pull apart. The project's goal is to elevate these issues in the public mind and to shape key debates around them, including public policy debates. This includes some essential questions. Can democracy and capitalism coexist? Is it too hopeful to say that these two forces have helped one another? Are they going to be perpetually at odds? What is the relationship between free markets and a free society? For me, at least, this has 2 questions. How do we balance economic freedom and political freedom? And how do we balance economic freedom and the well-being of American citizens? To lead and guide today's conversation, we are most honored to host a Miller Center friend, broadcast journalist Judy Woodruff. Judy is senior correspondent and former anchor and managing editor of PBS NewsHour. She has covered politics and other news for more than 4 decades at NBC, CNN, and PBS. She was the White House correspondent and chief White Washington correspondent for NBC from 1977 to 1983. Judy then joined PBS as chief Washington correspondent for what was then the McNeil-Lehrer NewsHour and anchored PBS's award-winning docuseries Frontline with Judy Woodruff. In 2013, along with the late Gwen Ifill, Judy co-anchored the nightly News Hour broadcast. And after Ms. Ifill's death, Judy served as sole anchor from 2018 until just this last December. She's the founding co-chair of International Women's Media Foundation and a recipient of more than 25 honorary degrees and numerous awards. She's a graduate of Duke University, which is ranked 4th in the ACC tournament this year. Which is good news for us because it means we wouldn't play them until the finals. We came to know Judy a decade ago through our mutual friend Jim Lehrer. I'm sure Judy regrets Jim's introduction to us, but we sure are appreciative. But as a sign of our gratitude, we now consider this room, where Judy appeared in May, as Judy's classroom. So Judy, welcome back to your classroom. Joining Judy are three dynamic thinkers who together will tackle and frame this essential question for all of you and for the other terrific participants of this two-day conference who have assembled here. I'll quickly introduce them and then turn it over to Judy, but with a brief word of thanks before doing so. Jamelle Bouie is columnist for the New York Times and political analyst for CBS News. He covers history and politics. Prior to the Times, Jamelle was chief political correspondent for Slate magazine. Before that, he was a staff writer at the Daily Beast and held fellowships at the American Prospect and the Nation magazine. Jamelle is Oahu. He attended UVA, where he graduated with a degree in political and social thought and government. Sid Milkis, between Judy and Jamelle, is the Miller Center's White Burkitt Miller Professor of Governance and Foreign Affairs, and has been Cavalier's Distinguished Teaching Professor and a UVA Professor of Politics, where he still runs the Honors Program, the best program at UVA. His research focuses on the American presidency, political parties and elections, social movements, and American political development. His many books include recently published Rivalry and Reform, President Social Movements, and the Transformation of American Politics, as well as What Happened to the Vital Center. And then finally, Scott Miller, last but not least, since Scott is in many ways the great convener of today's event, is a research fellow at the Miller Center and a lecturer and research associate at the Darden School of Business. From 2019 to 2021, he held a postdoctoral fellowship at Yale School of Management, International Center for Finance. As an economic historian, Scott examines the development of modern economic systems, particularly during periods of instability and volatility. I want to thank the supporters for this entire endeavor, including to the Hewlett Foundation, who supported this conference. That starts with Dick Mayo, Peter Grant, Virginia National Bank, Verizon, and Scott and T. Valor. We couldn't do this without your support, and we are deeply appreciative. So one logistical note, our panels will be happy to take questions toward the end of the program. So if you're here with us in person, please use the microphone at the back of the room. And if you are joining us online, please use the Q&A function on the bottom of the screen. We'll get to as many questions as we have time for. So thank you all again, and I'm going to turn it over to Judy. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bill. And if I had known you were going to bring up Duke and, you know, basketball, I might not have accepted, but it's okay. No, it's great to be back here at University of Virginia at the Miller Center. Bill is right. I was here not that long ago in the spring of last year and had a wonderful discussion then with Sid and with others. And it's always a treat to come back because you do such remarkable scholarly work here and you gather people who enlighten us all, and you've done it again today. So it's a treat for me to be here. We know this school is such a standout in the field of public policy, and I just have to mention, and you, I think, alluded to this, Bill, my late colleague Jim Lehrer, who was, of course, one of the founders of the NewsHour, had a connection here. He was on the board of advisors for the Miller Center and was a very vocal and active supporter of what you do here. And so there's a thread of connection for the PBS NewsHour here at the center. So I'm pleased to represent the NewsHour this afternoon, and I'm especially pleased to be moderating this plenary session, which will then kick off your two days to follow of really fascinating, important discussion on this question of democracy and capitalism, two huge subjects, and you've managed to pose what I might say is an unanswerable question, but we're going to answer it. We're going to answer it in the coming hour, and it's also why I'm able to say that, because I have these three extraordinary panelists in Sid Milkis and Jamelle Bouie, and of course with Scott Miller. So among the three of them, I've told them we're going to have a conversation. This is not going to be a strict Q&A. I want us to have a conversation among ourselves. Let's just start by posing the question, and you can either answer it or not. You can say yes, it is, or it isn't, or you know, here's the right question is something else. But Sid Milkis, I mean, is it possible in the truest sense of the words for democracy and capitalism to happen at the same time?
I don't know. I mean, I think it's a really fraught relationship, and that relationship has been the source of some of the most fundamental conflicts in our history, starting with the Constitution. Democracy calls for equality. Capitalism calls for the pursuit of profit. Free markets, which James Madison said, invariably leads to inequality. And so that that difference in objectives has made the relationship very difficult throughout our history. And in fact, at each one of our transformative moments, what I sometimes call refoundings, this battle has been ensued between democracy and capitalism. And some rapprochement has been achieved in each one of these periods, but it's never been a settled question in American politics.
So Jamelle Bouie, he's kind of ducked it. I mean, is it possible for the two to happen at the same time in the same place?
I mean, I don't want to duck the question either, but there are two things that are true, right? One thing that is true is that the United States has been, you know, a market society for its entire existence and has been a capitalist one for most of its existence, right? We've engaged in at least two stages of capitalism as a country. So it's true that sort of we have coexisted, right? American democracy has coexisted with capitalism. But there is that tension that Sid mentioned, the tension that sort of is inherent to sort of what both are, right? Like the tension inherent in capitalism is private ownership of production, of capital, but social organization of actual labor. You have the factory owner, but then the factory, which is a socially organized kind of thing. And democracy, about political equality of persons, about a community making decisions collectively for itself, about its conditions, runs headfirst into this part of capitalism, this private ownership of capital. And as Sid alluded to, throughout American history, you see very clearly when workers, as citizens, are upset with something, they want to be able to bring the power of the democratic community to bear on that thing. They want to be able to have some control over it. Because the kinds of power that can concentrate in capital, in private ownership of capital, does not exist in an easy relationship with the idea that democracy entitles all people within the community to be able to rule. And so that's like an inescapable tension. And ultimately, I think it depends on your view of capitalism, whether you think that is something that should just be teased out and lived with, or whether that's something that we should attempt to like get over and surpass, which might mean getting over and surpassing capitalism itself. Because I'm not sure you can really reconcile that with democracy. Or if you try to reconcile it with democracy, what kind of democracy are you gonna have at the end of it?
All right, I'll let you get away with that answer for now. Scott Miller, just a basic question. Can the two things exist in the same place?
Yeah, I agree with my colleagues here that it's a very difficult question, but I do believe that they can coexist, but they can coexist in a fraught push and pull world. There are absolutely times where the forces of capital can become a force of power that tries to overawe the will of the people. Like, that's absolutely true. But it's also very true that capitalism can provide the Alexis de Tocqueville called it the infrastructure of democracy, that the mechanics of interacting, of trading, of building, of innovating, and all the processes that come along with that can actually cause the networks through which people interact and learn to govern together actually become much, much stronger. So I would say it's not a perfect relationship, and it never will be, but I certainly believe that they definitely can and do coexist, especially compared to a lot of the alternatives.
Okay, we finally got somebody to answer. But Sid, let's go back, and you all have referred to this, but let's go back and talk about the founders and then bring it forward. What did they have in mind when they thought about democracy? And they thought, they may not have talked about it in exactly these terms. They didn't sit around and say democracy, tension with cap. But what did they see, and how, and this is another big question, how did that, how do you see that moving over time? You alluded to this just a minute ago.
So you want me to do both of those, how they see it and how does it move over time?
Why don't you start with how they saw it? Okay. Start with how they saw it.
Good, thank you. So Madison, who's really an important architect of the Constitution, argues in his justly famous Federalist 10 that if you have a pure democracy, that is, if people make laws and administer the government in person, that is incompatible with a free market economy, because majority factions will form, which will pursue wicked projects like the distribution of wealth, or a point that was very relevant to the time, getting rid of debt, because there was a real crisis then between debtors and debtees. So what you have to do is come up with and in the past, democracy has always led to majority factions that have oppressed minorities and has made liberty impossible. And an important part of liberty is the pursuit of property. So what you have to do is come up with a new political science. And a new political science is dedicated to forming a Republican government, which is distinguished from a direct democracy in two respects. One, you have a complicated system of representation, where the people delegate responsibility to a few who govern with the broader interest in mind on behalf of the people. And Madison says this has to be intricately formed. You have to have successive filtrations so that some of the institutions, and here he had in mind especially the presidency, the Senate, and the courts, so that some of the institutions separate the cup of power from the lips of the people quite a bit. The other thing you have to do is have politics rested in a large political orbit, that is, move power away from the states and localities, which was the case in the Articles of Confederation, which was a much more populist form of government. Now, just a final point, I'll pass the baton. The anti-federalists, who were very much opposed to the Constitution, thought that this Republican government, which was supposed to refine and enlarge the public views, really would mute the public views. And they were particularly concerned about the Senate and the courts in this respect. And so they argued this is an oligarchy which is disguised as a democracy. And so there's a real battle royale between the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists. And I think that battle is echoed throughout American history.
Jamelle, how do you read what the founders thought they were doing when they were thinking about these two concepts?
I think it's really useful when thinking about what the founders were doing is thinking about the philosophical and political traditions they were working out of, right? And so Madison, many of the framers were very familiar with the Italian city-states, with classical Italian republicanism, and familiar with people like Machiavelli, not necessarily the prince, but discourses on Livy, and the observations and conversations therein about the dangers of concentrated wealth in kind of these small city-state republics, right? That they allow oligarchies to develop, they allow aristocracies to develop, they allow concentrations of power to develop that aren't really responsive to the people at all. And although the American system isn't like directly designed right around that kind of fear, I do think there is an assumption, and you can see this assumption just in how the framers think about sort of the relationship between economic development and political liberty and these things. There is an assumption and recognition that the way this system, this Republican system we've set up, even though it's quite different than the Italian, the city-states are very different than classical Rome, even though it's this extended republic, use Madison's term, still needs to rest on some level of broad economic opportunity. if not outright economic equality. So the expansion into new territories, the availability of new land, the opening up of international trade, these things are important for the American Republic, not just because we want to be a wealthy and prosperous country, but because the only way we can sustain political equality, even among the rather limited set of people who have access to it, is if there's some level of egalitarianism in society. Because otherwise you will have not state concentrations of power, not state tyrannies, but non-state, private concentrations of power and authority, which will threaten the ability of the Republican system to persist. And so, even though this is a collection of merchants and planters and they're businessmen, there is this recognition that there needs to be broad prosperity and broad access to that prosperity for the system to actually work and sustain itself in the long term. And although you didn't ask the question, I'll say that this is an observation and an argument that comes up again and again post the founders. Like, what else is the Republican Party's call for free labor and free soil and free men, but a rearticulation of the idea that liberty and republicanism require opportunity, require some amount of egalitarianism in the society to survive.
Pick up on that, Scott. How do you read what was going on then, and respond to what Jamelle was saying?
Yeah. So, I mean, the first thing I'll say, and as a proud early Americanist from this glorious institution that we are at right now, the first thing I tend to say when we talk about the founders is be ultimately skeptical if anybody ever says the founders thought, because the founders didn't agree on anything. Let's be very clear on that. They had their debates, they had their battles within their own little sphere. And the times they actually agreed on something was far more rare than when they actually disagreed and fought like cats and dogs. What I find particularly interesting is, if you really want to boil this conflict down in the founding era, I would start by saying that this conflict between, can you have this expansive, we would probably call it capitalist to a degree, society and system, while still remaining free people, stretched far back, way past the founders. I mean, we're talking in the very earliest days of the colonial period. They're fighting this. If you begin and execute a consumer economy fueled by banks and paper money, does that corrupt you and make the society itself more degraded? These conversations were being had years, literally, after there was settlement in what is now the United States. But coming back to the founding era, I think, as with a lot of things in American history, if you want to boil it down, you can bring it down to Alexander Hamilton, the pop culture sensation these days, and Thomas Jefferson, in whose dome room we're sitting right now. And what's really interesting, I think, in this debate is we wouldn't recognize the terms with which they were arguing. And I would make the argument that somebody like Thomas Jefferson, making sure that there's no paintings or statues of him watching me when I say this right now, that he was very convinced, in fact, that you could not have what resembled a capitalist system and remain free. Hamilton did. Yeah. Jefferson believed if you have a system based on wage labor, on manufacturing, even to a degree on debt that was consolidated and passed down through time, that would inherently prevent the freedom of individuals. If you worked for a wage and you weren't able to have recourse to your own land, you by definition were not free. Jefferson said this again and again and again. And so when he became president and the policies he advocated for, it was, let's give people more land, continue proliferating this land so that people could inherently be more free and form this republic that way. Hamilton, on the other hand, said, no, you want people to have more land because you're the land holder. If more people have more land, you get to control the terms of the deal a little bit more. You're never gonna make people egalitarian. Society is always gonna have strata in it. What you wanna do is make those strata as fluid as possible, right? You're never gonna get rid of those. Allow people to rise and fall as their talents allow them to. And so Hamilton's mission was to create a system, not necessarily that made all people more equal, but allowed people to rise and fall as their merit allowed them to. And so this debate was something that started in the colonial period, moved into the founding era, and you see these dynamics going all throughout American history up until the present.
And pick up, and I want you, Sid, and Jamelle, I mean, pick up on that, because the debates were not resolved when we started out. I mean, they began, and I mean, as Scott just said, they dated well back to the very beginning of settling in this country. But at what point did those who thought capitalism, you know, again, with one, using another term, they might not have used the term capitalism, but who believed that property, that the ability to own property, to accumulate property and wealth and so forth, was preeminent, more important. At what point let me put it this way, at what points have we seen one or another ascendant? And then how has that been resolved? I mean, I'm thinking of the Gilded Age. I'm certainly thinking of, I mean, bring it all the way up to now, the financial crisis of 2008. Yeah. But, you know, pick what points you want to talk about.
I mean, putting it very schematically, the Jeffersonians controlled the 19th century, the Hamiltonians, or an inverted form of Hamilton, much more democratic notion of Hamiltonianism, dominates the 20th century. And I think what... The real shift from the Jeffersonian idea of a rural republic, you know, he's always praising the farmers as the chosen people of God, if God has a chosen people, he says. But I think that begins to shift after the Civil War. Yeah. And not a lot of people look, of course, the most important thing that happened in the Civil War was emancipation. But there's also a very important domestic program that's put in place in the 1860s that begins to foster what might be called an industrial capitalism, the gold standard, not quite the bank system that Hamilton envisioned, which was eliminated by the Jacksonians, but some kind of national banking system, since banks in the states had to be chartered, certain banks in the states had to be chartered by the national government, an income tax, and perhaps most important, a program to create an intercontinental railway system, which really began to dovetail the states and dovetail the economy. So you begin to get, you know, it's interesting, up to the Civil War, the states sometimes referred to themselves as countries still, and the United States was referred to in the plural. But after the Civil War, you begin to get a sense of a national economy. But once that national economy takes flight, and it takes flight mostly through the carrot rather than the stick, it takes us till the Gilded Age. And one of the most monopolistic, mischievous corporations, or trusts as they were called by the reformers, was the railroads, which had enormous power, which determined which towns would live and which towns would die, which discriminated between large and small shippers. So I think the industrial capitalism that really leads to the shift from Jefferson to Hamilton is planted after the Civil War, and that begins to really become much more formidable during the Gilded Age, the end of the 19th century.
And then, but pick up on that. I mean, that we've covered a lot of territory. Jamelle, we went from the founding, we're already in the 1890s. But what happened during that period that sort of laid the foundation for the debates, for the serious debates that we're having now?
So unfortunately, I'm not going to directly answer that because, but I'm going to get there kind of. Because Scott mentioned wage labor, and we've been trying to sort of figure out some succinct way of thinking about what capitalism means in relation to this question. And I think the reference to wage labor and Jefferson's belief that you can't be a wage laborer and sort of a free citizen is really important, because I think it actually does get to the heart of what the conflict is, which is that in sort of American-style republicanism, the part of the idea is this is sort of a society where, like, no one who is a full person really dominates over another person. No one who is free dominates or is dominated by other people. And being a small holding independent farmer, right, means that you're not subject to any kind of domination if you are, you know, a free white man, right, free white man land. Being an artisan means you are not necessarily subject to domination. But being a wage laborer makes you subject to domination. Being an enslaved person, obviously, makes you subject to domination. Occupying forms of what people would have described as degraded labor, right? You're not enslaved or anything. You may not even be a wage laborer, but you're working at the very bottom of the totem pole, makes you subject to domination. And so part of the question in the 19th century is, as the economy begins to industrialize, as people are moving into cities and moving into factories and moving away from farms and moving away from small rural villages and into towns and are beginning to take on wage labor, and it's not just Irish immigrants, it's not just German immigrants, it's, you know, Anglo-Americans whose grandfathers may have been landowners. Maybe they hope to be landowners too, but right now they are wage-earning people in a city. The question for them, you know, comes up is sort of like, well, what is the relationship now of myself to Republican freedom, to my standing as a free person? Because I am subject to this domination in my private life, but I'm still a free white man. And I think some of the major conflicts around capitalism and democratic life in the United States. I'm thinking of the populist movement in particular, but also the beginnings of the labor movement and the union movement are about trying to reconcile this question. How do you reconcile wage labor with Republican democracy in a way that preserves some measure of economic freedom, but also preserves our sense of what it means to be a Republican citizen? And the answers vary, right? The answers vary from, on the most radical end, well, I guess we can't have wage labor, right? I guess we can't have anyone dominating over another person in the realm of economic life. So that gets to your socialist movement, gets to your wobblies, right? Like the various radical economic movements. Maybe it means, in the case of the populists and the agrarian movement, maybe it means that we have to reduce the power of finance, reduce the power of those in the political system who are the ones who dominate over wage laborers, and then reorganize the economic system so that ordinary workers and farmers have some measure of democratic control over how the economy is planned. Maybe we can't, in sort of kind of a Hamiltonian way, maybe we can't ever get rid of this kind of labor, but we can structure who controls it. Or the solution we actually come to, right, is we just say, well, we have wage labor now, and that's what we're going to do, and it's going to be up to Americans organizing through, you know, political means to at least begin to change the terms then of what Republican citizenship means. We end up not really changing the terms of what wage labor means. Right. We end up changing the terms of what it even actually means to be a citizen, and what that even actually means to exercise Republican freedom. And maybe it no longer means total non-domination in your life. Maybe it means an affirmative ability to participate. Maybe it means an ability to be a free consumer, right? You see a consumer culture emerge and consumer ideology emerge in the 1910s and 20s as, in a lot of ways, a reaction to the failures of populism, a way to say, well, we can't wrestle control of the economy from the J.P. Morgans and all those people, but maybe if we can create enough bounty, we can act freely as consumers in society. And so I'm getting to your question, kind of. I think if you look at it in those terms, in sort of the question not being so much like, can capitalism coexist, but can Republican freedom coexist with these forms of labor that render the laborers themselves non-independent, then you get to see the kinds of answers that Americans come up with.
Scott, you've been nodding for so much of what he's been saying.
Yeah. No, I think, I mean, the wage labor question, I'm really glad we got to it, because I think it's really fundamental here. And wage labor is not a problem at all if there is a free labor market, right? In theory, if some employer is driving your wage down and you're a productive worker, you should be able to go to another employer who will pay you a wage that you want to be paid. What Jefferson said, what people in the antebellum era said, even up through the Gilded Age said, that will not happen unless you have some kind of leveling agent, is that you have to make sure that all the employers do not collude to make sure that your wages are pressed down and pressed down and pressed down. That's really, really important, I think, and that's a really important issue that we need to consider as we're looking at the Republican nature or the Democratic nature of how a capitalist economy works. Because if you want to have a system which has a lot of benefits in terms of a wage labor system, how do you allow that, like Jamelle said, in a way where the employers cannot all get together and say, hey, nobody's gonna pay over this barely subsistent wage. We can debate, and Jefferson would say, well, it doesn't even matter if they're making all the money in the world because they are still taking their orders from somebody else, and that is inherently a suppression of your individual liberty. I would say that's probably a minority view these days, but the question of a fluid and a labor market where you can get the wage that you at least theoretically deserve is a fundamental question, and one that we're dealing with right now in terms of antitrust and that kind of thing.
Antitrust and then so many other debates. Sid, I mean, on this campus, I'm told a few days ago, Senator Bernie Sanders was here.
Yes, he was.
And I wasn't here to, maybe you heard the remarks, but yes. I mean, this morning when I woke up, the first thing I heard on NPR was that he, in the new book, which he has just published, which is coming out, among other things, he spends a lot of time focusing on the fact that, what is it, three billionaires have more, are worth more than the entire lower half of the American economy, income earners in this country. I mean, we've come a long way from, we've wrestled with these questions, but we still have a lot of wrestling to do. We're dealing with gaping inequities in our system. So how did we get here? How did we get to this place?
How did we get to this?
To where we are right now.
Wow, we jumped all the way.
You can see it's because I'm looking at how much time we have.
Can I wait till tomorrow morning? Just about the Bernie Sanders thing, and you were there. It was really interesting to witness, because it shows you that among young people, and I teach here. My students cannot be stereotyped as radical, but a number of them, even many of them who consider themselves moderate, who I know joined you at that event, are very attracted to social democracy or democratic socialism. And he got greeted like a rock star. This was in the other iconic building at UVA. It was in Old Cabell Hall. It was packed on the night before break. Mick Jagger himself, who's about the same age as Bernie, couldn't have packed that place the way Bernie Sanders packed it. And his explanation is, and the title of his new book is, "It's Okay to Be Angry About Capitalism." And his reason for the viral inequality is the system is rigged. That the rich have all the rules on their side, that there's this hard and fast barrier, there's no fluidity, there's this hard and fast barrier between billionaires, which Bernie doesn't think we should allow for, the rank and file Americans who live paycheck to paycheck. And because of those systems are rigged, the attack on unions, globalization, campaign finance rules. He believes that there's no reconciliation possible, I think, between democracy and capitalism. Now, he's not invoking Eugene Debs, as he once was, who's probably who won 6% of the vote in 1912 as a socialist candidate. I think no socialist has won more than that in a presidential campaign. Now he's invoking Franklin Roosevelt, which I saw as a step towards more moderation. So it's a subtle difference, but I think now he's preaching, I think he's now preaching a social democracy rather than a democratic socialism. And the difference is there's not a call for great redistribution, although he does call for a more graduated income tax. There's a call to provide some foundation of security for the middle, for the working class in American society. And he invoked Franklin Roosevelt's idea of a new Bill of Rights, that the government has the responsibility to protect individual men and women from the abuses of big business and the terrifying insecurity of the marketplace. And it does so through two mechanisms, full-blown welfare state, and Roosevelt was argued that health care should be considered a right in the United States, and also through regulation, some kind of regulation of these large corporations who wield way too much power in the United States.
So I don't want to make it only about Bernie Sanders and what he's arguing,
but
he is saying things that resonate with a lot of people, not just young people.
I think the Sanders is reference or claiming of Roosevelt is not, I don't think it's simply like aesthetic. I don't think it's the thing he's doing just for rhetorical purposes, because you know the thing about the New Deal period is that it is just this time in American history where it is an open question among ordinary Americans whether or not capitalism can survive, or whether or not democracy can survive in a capitalist society. That, you know, by 1932, what, it's like a quarter of the American public is unemployed, has been unemployed for years at that point, mass immiseration of Americans, and it's a serious concern whether the American Republic can survive as a republic or as a capitalist society, one or the other. And so the New Deal is like a literal New Deal, right? Sort of, we're going to try to renegotiate the terms of not just what American capitalism is, but what American republicanism is. And so on the American capitalism side, we're going to say that a free enterprise system, a free market system, can still have heavy government involvement. It can still have heavy redistribution. It can still have you can have experts and administrators working directly on the economy. That is okay. But on the side of what American republicanism is, American republicanism is going to include guarantees of economic security. And it's not necessarily going to mean that you're going to be able to have your own homestead out in the frontier, because there's no frontier anymore. There's no land. It's closed. But what it does mean is that a free, independent person who works a job, an industrial job on the floor, will be able to participate in the union, will have enough income to have a home and raise a family, right? Like the Fordist economic order that emerges and takes center stage after the war. And so I think Sanders is without, you know, putting it in necessarily these terms, is sort of hearkening back to this pre-World War II crisis of capitalism, and also this notion that that the problem of capitalism is in part a problem of sort of like, how do we conceptualize living in a democracy, living in a democratic society. The other thing I'll add real quick is that, and this is just like an observation that's related to why Sanders is so popular amongst young people, and I think you can't discount the impact of, you know, today's 18-year-olds being little kids during the Great Recession, right? Like, I'm 35, so I was graduating from college during the Great Recession, and you just have like a cohort of Americans whose formative moments from either being kids to young adults is this catastrophic economic collapse and then slow recovery, right? So that's one part of it, but also the older cohort of this generation, people my age, we are like the first group of post-Cold War Americans who have no living memory of the Cold War conflict, of the conflict with communism and the Soviet Union. And so I think that means a couple things. One of them is that This is a generation of Americans who does not necessarily grow up with the fear of socialism and fear of alternatives to capitalism that is part of kind of Cold War life, because there's no Khrushchev, there's no Brezhnev, there's no kind of evil empire that represents these things. There's Putin, but like Putin, like Russia is like a, you know, corona capitalist society at this point, so it's like, you know, different.
There's capitalism, and then there's capitalism.
Right. There's capitalism. There's like a worse, more terrible form of it.
Mercantilism.
Right. But also, I think what the end of the Cold War does for American politics in a lot of ways is whatever strictures it put around ideological conflict in the country, either on the right or on the left, the end of the Cold War, in over time, dissolves them completely. And so it opens up the space again for critiques of capitalism, but it also opens up the space for critiques of cosmopolitanism, for critiques of liberalism, in a way that wasn't the case during the Cold War. So that's just like a related observation.
Scott, thoughts on this?
I could not agree with Jamelle more. I think that one of the things, because I interact with a lot of students here, I tend to teach MBAs at the Darden School, but we do a lot of things with the Project on Democracy and Capitalism with undergraduates. And I don't think that the fact that their formative years, quite literally, I mean, they were 9, 10, so the first moment they're kind of becoming familiar with the world, the only thing they knew was this period of time. And so I would argue, and I've seen evidence of this, that it's incumbent upon us as faculty at an institution to be able to explain to these students, okay, you're free to have whatever opinions you want to have on democracy and capitalism. That's completely your prerogative. But let's try to understand what these things actually are, because when you talk to students, they are, in my opinion, they tend to be reacting against the worst of capitalism and what they saw in very real terms. I do not blame them on this at all. A couple of nights ago, we had a debate with a couple of debating societies here at UVA on a premise similar to the one we're talking about. And I would say that it was a pretty darn anti-capitalist crowd of about 100 undergraduates. We gave our verdict actually in favor of the capitalist side in this particular case. They were not particularly thrilled. But we came out and we did a Q&A at the end, and it was very, very interesting for me as an instructor. The faces in the crowd were quite antagonistic at first. But then as we started going in and talking to, okay, do we want the government? Do you want the government, including when you lose an election, the government run by Donald Trump or Republicans to be in charge of the economy? They would say, no, absolutely not. Do you want, and then you go down the list, and it seems that they want a decent social safety net that is involved, and they think that that cannot exist in a capitalist system. And as soon as you break that bond and say, well, I would personally argue on virtually every metric that Sweden and Denmark are pretty darn capitalistic, their face changes completely and totally. There's an understanding. It's like, oh, wait a second. What I have seen my entire life is the brittleness of that system, not necessarily what can be done in it that is well and can benefit our society. And then, in my opinion, as somebody who really cares about talking about these things with students, that's a place where you can start. It's like, okay, what is capital and what is democracy? How do they interact? How do they form this one thing that is democratic capitalism, that is an entity in and of itself, and not necessarily just a push and pull between two antithetical concepts? And I think that's super important.
We're going to, Sid, did you want to respond?
I just wanted to add a footnote that this generation, I know from my own children, are saddled with considerable debt. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of them are hungry for economic opportunity, which has become more difficult for them for a lot of reasons, mm-hmm. but debt is one of them. And one of the most popular things Bernie said was, what Joe Biden's done, $10,000, $20,000, that's a good start. But we have to go much further. We have to get rid of all student debt. And he got a huge ovation.
Yeah. I think he certainly would get a huge ovation for that. I mean, that makes sense.
If you look at the cost of universities, that's a legitimate gripe in many ways.
That's another entire
subject. We don't want to attack the university.
In about 5 minutes, we're going to take questions from all of you. But I just want to ask the three of you. I'm thinking. I mean, are we wasting our time even having this conversation, because it's just gotten, I mean, the forces that move us in the direction of, I don't know, where our economy is and where our politics is, which today is so divided. Mm. I mean, what value is there in having these conversations, do you think?
I think there's tremendous value in having them. Because even though this relationship between democracy and capitalism is fraught, it's through conversations like this and political conflict and debate, we reach enough of a reconciliation to move on with a commitment to both democracy and capitalism. I think the New Deal is a good example of that, where we redefine the social contract. We commit ourselves to economic security. Roosevelt even, in the 1936 platform, Democratic platform. And this is a huge election. This is what establishes the New Deal Democratic Party as a majority party until the 1960s. And Roosevelt drafted that platform. It starts out in the cadence of the Declaration of Independence. We hold this truth to be self-evident. And the new truth, the new individualism, he says, is security, that we have to provide a platform for people to live with the kind of security that Jefferson thought they could only find on a small farm or as a small craft person. And I think we're going through another one of these moments where we're trying to redefine the social contract. This happens in periods when you have great polarization. Social and economic disruption, monopoly control so that the market begins to look like an oligarchy. Every time we've had one of these periods, we've gone through a difficult political period, but one in which we redefine the social contract. And there are some efforts going on now. There's new attention to the concentration of economic power. The Federal Trade Commission is really taking a hard look at high-tech companies in a way that hasn't happened since the 1980s. I believe we're looking at, and I'll just mention this, and then I'll pass the baton to my colleagues. But we're looking at things like tax credits for families, tax allowances, which was part of the American Rescue Plan, but it was only established for a year, and then it was in the Build Back Better program. But of course, as we know, that didn't pass. That's a huge step in thinking about a welfare state and new steps towards how to solve poverty. In the year it was in place, it reduced children's poverty by one half and reduced it to the lowest rate it has ever been. And of course you say, well, the Republicans are never going to go for this. But we got new Republicans now who aren't afraid to use the government. And some people like Mitt Romney are interested in this program because they see it as pro-family. So I think these conversations are absolutely essential. Now, of course, they have to go beyond campuses, they have to go beyond grounds. But I think if we don't have these conversations, if we're all in our own silos, then we're going to have another civil war. We're already in the cold civil war. We certainly don't want to have a hot civil war.
Jamelle, what do you think?
Yeah, I think these conversations are valuable, especially now, for the simple reason that, you know, for much of the last 30 or 40 years, the reigning assumption has been the kind of like market supremacy in American society, that it's not just that we're a capitalist country, but that we're going to organize so much of our economic and political and then social life under the market. You're not simply going to go to school because it is enriching, you're going to go to school because it boosts your human capital, right? Like even the fact that like people know the phrases like human capital exists is a testament to how much market thinking has, infected, gives away my perspective, how much market thinking has structured our understanding of ourselves. And these conversations about attention or conflict or the coexistence of democracy and capitalism, I think can help people recognize and understand that that particular order was a constructed one, right? It's nothing inevitable about the fact that we subordinate everything to the market. And also that you can think, there's no reason you can't think of capitalism, can't think of market society as being subject to some kind of democratic control, right? Like one way to alleviate some of the tension is to allow the public through its representative institutions to have some measure of control over what happens in the economy, whether that's providing security for people, whether that is sectional bargaining, right? Like creating councils in which workers and employers have to bargain together. There are a million ways you could do it, but I think an important way of getting there, of getting to the idea that that regulation of the economy in this way is not some violation of a taboo, but actually part of what democratic life is, is having these kinds of conversations and beginning to reintroduce the idea to the broader public that there is nothing natural about capitalism, right? And there's nothing natural about democracy either. And that it's for that reason that we can tailor and structure these things to our needs rather than to some, objective sense of what has to be.
Scott.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely vital to have these conversations and talk about these two issues, democracy and capitalism, in tandem. Because if you look back beyond the point where we kind of separated them in the 1920s and 1930s, these things were always taught and discussed together. I mean, if you look back at like I mentioned before, at the colonials or Hamilton and Jefferson, what they weren't saying, oh, well, capitalist this, democracy this, you know, we'll make a trade here, we'll make a trade here. What they're essentially saying is, how do we make the United States or what will be the United States more free? And that incorporates the political realm and that incorporates the economic realm. There is not these two different things that you have to polarize them into. And you know, it's really interesting if you look at whether it be Hamilton and Jefferson or Tocqueville or Daniel Webster, or you move into the Gilded Age and you're looking at the laissez-faire king of William Graham Sumner or Henry George, who was branded a socialist. Whenever they're talking about either capitalism or democracy, the other one always comes in, always. And so I would argue that we're participating in a very long American and indeed global, but in our particular case, American tradition of not trying to put capitalism in its corner and democracy in its corner, but saying, hey, these things actually interact with each other a lot. We should probably look at them in tandem or else we're gonna miss something.
Great, and what a great note to turn to all of you. It's your turn to ask questions or respond in some way. There's a microphone. Please don't be bashful. Tell us your name, if you would.
Hi, thanks all for a terrific conversation so far. I'm Robert Lieberman from Johns Hopkins.
Could you speak up?
Yeah, sorry. I'm Robert Lieberman from Johns Hopkins University. I want to pick up on an observation that Scott made a little while ago, which is that there are other countries that are both democratic and capitalist. You mentioned Sweden and Denmark, but you could add to that list. And it feels like in many other countries, the relationship between democracy and capitalism is less fraught than it has been in the United States for a very long time. So I wonder if there are specific things about American democracy or American capitalism or both that you think lead us to have this particularly tense historical relationship between democracy and capitalism. Thanks.
Did you want to direct that to you mentioned Scott.
Anyone who wants to answer that.
Anybody. I'll let you start. I've been going first all this
time. Oh, sure, we'll reverse the order, awesome. I think what you're saying is absolutely correct. I was talking with a group of students several years ago and they called Denmark a socialist paradise, and then I talked to some Danish friends and they laughed out of the room that they're socialist. So I think that there is very, very, very different ways that we can look at this. My guess, and I'd have to think about this in a little bit more depth, is that the Cold War, especially for right now, really kind of did a number on the current conversation as it was. There are other forces that played into this in the kind of the pre-Cold War world. But when you have the Cold War and you have, this is what America is. This is what the Soviets are. This is not the system of government they have or the economic system that they have. I would argue that a lot of times today, and I said this at a recent Miller Center event, being a capitalist is an identity marker. You don't say, oh, I believe in free markets, innovation, blah, 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 blah. No, I am a capitalist. It is who I am. And I think a lot of that kind of spun out of the Cold War in this particular case, but I'll hand off to my colleagues for other thoughts on this.
We're not going to let you off, though.
Yeah, I know. I mean, so the way I'm taking the question is sort of like why, you know, Sweden, Denmark, France, Germany, they have various flavors of social democracy. So they, you know, they have the capitalist economies, but like a heavy hand for the state in providing for people and not necessarily regulation, but simply providing social benefits to people. And the big difference for them versus us is that although we have had a labor movement, we've never really had labor parties, right? Yeah. American democracy never really developed labor parties for a variety of reasons, I think. But I think this is kind of one of the big differences between our two experiences, that the existence of large labor parties, which, you know, at one point in Germany, the Social Democratic Party was like one of the largest parties in Germany at one point in the early 20th century. So you have these powerful labor parties that have a huge impact on state building and a huge impact on the development of those welfare states. That just, we don't have something similar in the United States. It's funny, the only other thing I'll add here is that the Cold War is interesting in that it does two things, kind of, you know, mutually contradictory. The first is that, yes, because we are facing off against kind of the communist country, the paradigmatic communist country, we are God-fearing, democratic, free enterprise, that's the United States. But it's also precisely because the Soviet Union was a legitimate competitor, right? And late in the game, we don't really have, we're not really super aware of how fragile that system is. But in the 40s and the 50s, and to some extent the 60s, the Soviet Union appears to be pound for pound as strong, as able to grow, as prosperous as the United States is. And so this also has an effect on the American capitalist class. It has an effect on owners of capital who essentially agreed to things they may have never agreed to in different circumstances, agree to this sort of broad private welfare state with unions, agree to a more activist and interventionist government on economic matters, because there is a real threat out there. There's a real alternative out there. And I'll end this by saying, I think it is interesting that you have this dramatic rightward turn in, you know, the American owners of capital around the time the Soviet Union begins to collapse, right? Like around the time American democracy and American capitalism can rise triumphant is you see a lot of retrenchment in terms of the government's intervention in the economy and capital's willingness to support it and abide it.
I don't know what to say in response to this, too. So I just say quickly, this is really simple-minded, Rob. How are you, by the way? This power of individualism in the United States, you know, which is something Tocqueville picks up on when he comes in the 1830s. And it's really interesting that Tocqueville's the first one to really take off from the idea of individualism and analyze how democracy will work. He doesn't coin the term, but he analyzes it. And it's rooted most strongly in the United States because of the absence of a feudal tradition. Yeah. And so in Europe, where they think class, the idea of class comes is pretty comfortable, even now, that's never been comfortable in the United States. There's always this sometime tortuous effort to figure out how a society so dedicated to individualism can reform itself. So when William Jennings Bryan is condemning business in his famous Cross of Gold speech, he says the problem with these business elites is they have too narrow a definition of business. We're all businessmen. The lawyer's the businessman. The farmer's the businessman. The grocer is the businessman. Mm-hmm. And so this absence of class identity, this emphasis on individualism, creates a kind of a real antithesis to a strong state in the United States. Now, we kind of have a strong state. We've had one since the New Deal, but we have a love-hate relationship with that state. And so if you think of democratic capitalism, it sort of implies a responsive government and also a regulated market. And achieving those things in the United States is not impossible, but it always has to be done in kind of a sui generis American way. Wait, I'm getting choked up as I say this, which emphasizes individualism in a way that makes us look very difficult from Europe, I think.
Next question.
Hi, John Woodworth. Let me try a notion on this, dealing with the interaction between democracy and capitalism. What part in triggers it is one of the comments that you made about during the Industrial Revolution, the tendency of the monopolies or the trusts to collude to try to keep wages down. So kind of reversing that in a sense and thinking about our own democratic society and how it might be conduct itself, whether with government involvement or without, is there any notion of on the private enterprise side of the equation of a sort of code of conduct? I don't know, the Chamber of Commerce will work together with all industry and business to work out a code of conduct about the ratio of income in industries and businesses and how it's distributed, a fair ratio between the highest paying members of any particular enterprise and the employees. And that this is done not through government mandate, but rather through, I don't know, a socially derived code of conduct, if you will, that is over time developed and agreed to by industry.
Just one of you want to tackle this?
Not all three.
Yeah, one of you tackle this because we've got maybe three other questions.
Yeah, I'm the historian, so I get to stick in the past and then let these guys deal with the present. It's much better.
But you have to
better,
cover the whole waterfront because you're answering this question.
Yeah, better to deal with it, yeah. So I would say that from a cultural perspective in dealing with these issues, that is a paradigm that has existed before and I think is a model. There was a glorious book by a UVA historian named Stephen Innes, who's unfortunately no longer with us, called Creating the Commonwealth, and it was about Puritan New England and the capitalist culture of Puritan New England. And the argument he makes is that the culture, a mixture of religion, of societal relationships, of the various responsibilities they had to each other under God in this particular case, would keep a leash on that abuse in the system. And I think that kind of culture, however we say it, actually can have a very distinct and driving influence on how these kind of non-governmental arrangements are actually made. Tocqueville actually made a very, very similar, right, this is the Tocqueville session apparently, but he made a very similar observation. He was very concerned about this consolidation, but he believed that Americans' culture, religion, kind of duty to each other would be the one that would actually keep this in line, not the government. So there's certainly models that have popped up in the past. Whether those are directly applicable in today's era, I'm not quite sure.
Okay, we've got about 4 minutes left, so we've got time at least for one question and maybe two. Go ahead, sir.
My name is Samuel Hellman. I'm a University of Chicago person, but I'm a doctor, so not an economist. Two things I think have been alluded to a little bit, but in my mind are much more central. The first is natural rights. That's what the Founding Fathers were most about. Natural rights, and someone brought up healthcare as a natural right coming to existence. So I want to frame one example, and that is medicine. That's the one that people are talking about. It's a natural right. And the second concept is efficiency. Society has to be efficient. And if we look at the countries that you alluded to, which are social democracies or democratic socialists, that all but us have a healthcare system that's far more efficient, costs less money, costs less for the less part of the gross national product, and are better than ours when it comes to equitable distribution. And they may not be better than ours in the best, but they surely are better in the way they're put in. So when one talks about capitalism and talks about democracy, it seems to me they have to be in the framework of natural rights, what's everybody entitled to, and secondly, that they have to be an efficient government.
Who would like to tackle this one?
Well, you know, one of the things that has been contested is what natural rights mean, or whether we can really celebrate natural rights as Jefferson did in the Declaration of Independence, because natural rights means that you have a right as an individual that's pre-political, which means you should limit government as much as possible. Paine makes much of this in his really important pamphlet. But when you get to Lincoln and you have the problem of slavery, Lincoln argues, he doesn't argue against natural rights, he argues that the organic, the Declaration of Independence is the organic principle that holds the Union together. But nevertheless, he says, in a subtle way, he gives a more positive view of liberty than Jefferson does. And now government has to do a lot. And what, I mean, think about slavery, what a powerful institution that is. And he says, government, and he said this in his first speech to Congress, and he picks July 4th to do it, July 4th, 1861. And he says the government has the responsibility to provide individuals an unfettered start and a fair chance in the race of life. And the government has to provide that. No invisible hand is going to provide that. That idea of a more positive liberty, which challenges, I think, this idea of natural rights, becomes much more robust with Roosevelt, who's preaching a new Bill of Rights, programmatic rights. And it's not just a theory. Social Security, which is our biggest program now being debated, embodies this new idea. And Roosevelt wouldn't argue, well, this isn't a natural right, but the meaning suggests, the meaning is there, that we have a positive view of liberty so that government has a responsibility to provide the individual with the rights the individual needs to prosper. Necessitous men, he says, are not free men.
All right.
I hope that's responsive.
We've been given permission to have one more question.
We can stay here all night.
We've got several
We paid for this microphone.
You can fight over the
microphone. I think Sid Morales asked my question, so I'm going to...
Can we take both of them? And then maybe.
My name's Davis. I'm a retired doc and a poultry farmer. I'm thinking that there's an elephant in the room that has not been addressed in any way, and it's the national debt. And I wonder whether the combination of the freedoms that we have, democracy, even in a republic, combined with capitalism, leads to huge debt, which seems to me ever growing. And I say that because we're all children. We don't look to the future. In all of the decisions that are made to get people elected have to do with immediate gratification. And I don't see any control on this, and I wonder in this setting whether there isn't this insidious thing there that there really isn't very good control on spending.
Jamelle, you get this one.
Yeah, yeah, take us home.
I mean, I don't want to just like, you know, say my own personal policy views here. I think that to the extent that there isn't much concern with the quantity of debt anymore, I do think it's because the American political classes, for the most part, decided it's going to focus less on the question of reducing debt and more on the question of just increasing economic growth and really focusing on the growth of an expansion of the economy under the presumption that like a growing economy can take on debt as much as it needs to. I do think it is interesting how debt has sort of like eclipsed from American political thinking in a major way. You go to the founding era, lots of concern about debt, right? Go to the Civil War era, tons of concern about debt. The United States is hugely indebted during the Civil War. But in the age of global financial markets, in the age of massive economies and hugely productive economies, even as politicians pose and argue and fight and dance about the debt for television cameras, when it comes to like policymakers and the decisions they make, it's clear that it's not really that big of a concern for anyone anymore. I think that has a lot to do with just sort of how the global economy and how the American economy has changed in the last half century.
End of the questions. Have anybody changed his mind about whether democracy and capitalism can coexist before we thank you all? You get special dispensation. The three of you have been fantastic.
I was going to say I'm leaning to yes.
All right, we got a little bit of a shift.
I'll be persuaded.
They've been fantastic. Sid Milkis, thank you very much. Jamelle Bouie. And Scott, thank you very much, all three of you. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Judy.
Terrific new career is something called America at a Crossroads. I really encourage everybody to watch it on PBS. She's exploring a series of issues in our democracy. Her first one was on political polarization, and we know that that it's gonna be a terrific ride along those crossroads, or turns at various crossroads, and we hope to be along with it with her. So Judy, again, thank you for coming, and to the whole PBS team that we've been lucky to work with now twice, and we hope more in the future. And finally, to our own team at the Miller Center, it's a big team. Christina Lopez, Gattardi Chow, and Alfred Reeves work hard to put this event together. Our development team really helps manage a lot of our events, and obviously our great AV team, and everybody else, including many governing council members who are here. We thank you all, and thank all of you for coming, and enjoy this beautiful day. One cheer for global warming.